So, good evening, everyone, and a very warm welcome here at the library of the Goethe-Institut Max Mueller Bhavan. The State of Nature in India lecture series aims to provide a multidisciplinary platform in order to better understand complexities of anthropogenic processes with a focus on India, and this is the fourth edition this year. This evening, we would like to welcome Mukul Sharma, who will talk about Dalit and green politics, followed by a discussion with Ravi Agarwal and a Q&A session. Mukul Sharma is presently a professor at the Indian Institute of Mass Communication, New Delhi. He was a special correspondent in Navbharat Times in Delhi from 1983 to 1998, and has received 12 national and international awards for his environmental, rural, and human rights journalism. Between the 1990s and the 2000s, he was visiting fellow at the University of Oxford, the London School of Economics, and the Mahidol University in Thailand. He has been the director of Amnesty International and Heinrich Böll Foundation in India, and worked with several developmental organizations, networks, and forums. He has published 16 books and booklets in English and Hindi. The latest one, Caste and Nature, Dalits and Indian Environmental Politics, from 2017, is dealing with the topic of tonight's discussion. Ravi Agarwal is an interdisciplinary practitioner and an artist, photographer, environmental campaigner, writer, and curator. His work explores key contemporary questions of ecology, society, and capital, and has been widely shown in Asia as well as in Europe. Ravi is also the founder and director of the environmental NGO Toxics Link. He serves on policy and regulatory committees and boards, writes extensively on sustainability issues, has co-edited books on these topics, and received several awards for his work. The series is conceptualized in collaboration with him, and we are very happy to have you back, and you will also be back later this month twice. Thank you all for coming tonight, and I wish all of you an insightful and inspiring evening. Thank you.
So thank you very much. I'm very happy to be a part of the State of Nature in India lecture series. Thanks to Goethe-Institut, Max Mueller Institute, Mumbai, Ravi Agarwal, Amruta, for continuing this series. You have rightly mentioned about the complexities of anthropogenic processes in your call that are so pronounced all over in terms of the impact of human activities in our environment, the accumulation of greenhouse gases, losses of biodiversity, and so on and so forth, that we humans are now no longer objects of nature, but have become active subjects. That somebody called an academician, subjects in the co-evaluation of socio-ecological system. Thus, certainly, we have the obligation to consider and work towards what sort of environment we wish to live in, how to produce it, and with what consequences. From this perspective, the question of the production of nature becomes very high on our agenda. And from seeing this entire question from a cross-disciplinary perspective, as again you have mentioned in your call. So for me, the focus of this agenda should be on a socio-physical historical nature that reconsider and re-script nature and the matter of nature in political terms. And here, the question of caste become very important to understand the re-scripting and reconsidering the nature and our society. It is sometimes very heartening to see the growing consensual concern with nature. The elevation of environmental concern is certainly encouraging at times. However, for me, there is a paradoxical situation here whereby the environment is organizationally, politically mobilized, yet this concern with the environment, as sometime presently articulated in our country, is argued to suspend many important political, social dimensions of environment. And here, caste is one such important suspended dimension in our understanding of nature in India. If we open the caste box, then we begin to see several new important questions. For example, you problematize the question of nature and the environment. You see that there is no such thing as a singular nature around which an environment or climate policy or future can be constructed and harmonized. Rather, there are multitudes of nature or multitudes of existing possible or practical socio-natural relations, and the proper politicization of nature of the environment or the environment needs to endorse this heterogeneity. A singular nature, in my understanding, does not exist. There is no trans-historical or trans-geographical natural state of things, or natural state of conditions, or natural state of relations, but there are rather different historical nature, historical natural relations, or environments that are subject to continuous change and transformation. If you bring Dalits in, and I will explain all these things in detail later, you will see that the nature we see and work, the way we imagine or script as nature, these inscriptions are always inadequate. They leave a gap, and they maintain a certain distance from the other co-produced nature that are there, which are complex, at times very much conflict-ridden, being built in very strange way with strange attractors. If we go further with Dalits into this path, we sometimes find, and I will certainly explain all these later, that there is no nature out there that needs or requires salvation in name of nature itself or a generic humanity. So these are the broad thoughts before beginning with my structured presentation here. Before getting into the formal talk, some minor clarifications that when I deploy the term Dalit, I deploy this term in a larger, inclusive, encompassing sense. We are all aware of the fact that this category Dalit does not mean a singular identity. Their caste, subcaste, their divisions, competition, compromises, and they have multiple complex narrative about nature and environment and their ecological argumentation. So we are aware of this fact. Secondly, when I say green politics, again, we know that extremely heterogeneous and wide and vivid. In the context of Dalit and caste, I will be talking about certain strands of Indian green politics, which, according to me, are very strong, dominant in the present Indian environmental politics. Thirdly, my talk here will be taking a lot from my earlier published work, which came out, which today I will be giving it to Ranjit. So we could not exchange last time. So let's begin. Of course, I'm continuing with this work, and now I'm working on the Dalit nature writing, that why Indian nature writing does not take any account of Dalit writing within. So there are many strains of this work, which this book is also coming out in Hindi next month and likely to be published in other languages, so and so forth. So there are certain development, but in the limited time today, I will broadly focusing on this work. Second is that, let's begin with Indian green politics. As I said that vividly and variously defined as environmentalism of the poor, indigenous environmentalism, middle class environmentalism, elite environmentalism, ecofeminism, red and green. I myself worked on green and saffron and much more, revealing its diversity and dynamism. Environmental themes and concerns appear across a wide spectrum of organizations and groups. Scholarship and on environmental issues and movement and debates on developments have particularly focused on the voices and visions of tribals and women, indigenous population and women. However, while Dalits or lower caste people have often participated in significant numbers in various environmental initiatives and movements, they have been largely missing in most studies as a specific categories like gender or indigenous population and so on and so forth, as they are usually merged in the general definition of poor, marginal, displaced, environmental refugees, and migrants. So there appears to be an environment blindness on questions of caste, or an understanding of a specifically Dalit position on ecological politics. This is my understanding based on my research. And mind you, this is not only a concern of an academician, or this is not only my concern. Of late, several Dalits and anti-caste intellectuals have begun questioning ecological and political trajectories of contemporary green politics in India. For example, a small but very significant piece by well-known academician Gail Omvith, titled Why Dalits Dislike Environmentalists, pointed to the alienation between two of the most powerful social movements in India, the anti-caste movement and the environment movement. Dalit intellectual Chandrabhan Prasad, in another article titled The New Life Movement versus Narmada Bachao Andolan, Save the Narmada Movement, invoked Ambedkar's notion of a new life movement, his ideas on modernity, and his critique of Gandhian traditionalism as arguments for a rejection of the Narmada Bachao Andolan in general and Medha Patkar in particular. Academician and activist Kancha Ilahi refers to environmentalism as exclusive, devoid of any concerns and relationship with the builders of environment on earth. He argues that this so-called secular environmentalism is not bothered about the nationalist and hegemonic social structure that Brahmanism has built. Examples from several environmental movements also bring out their caste blindness, or more importantly, their implicit pro-caste and anti-Dalit bias. Movements like Narmada Bachao Andolan or the Chilka Bachao Andolan certainly deployed a creative redefinition of human rights by closely linking their movements with right to life and livelihood. But issues of Dalits and caste discrimination were completely neglected. An examination of the Narmada Bachao Andolan revealed that the movement's areas and villages continued to be characterized by higher caste domination. Caste discrimination was an everyday reality. Dalit participation in the movement was very limited. Dalits had not been part of the decision-making processes. They were lacking in confidence to participate in the movement, and no organization existed for them and the landless laborers. My own detailed study about the Tehri Dam movement led by Sundarlal Bahuguna, which is part of my previous book, Green and Saffron, and others, amply showed Dalits' discontent over the nature and demands of the anti-Tehri Dam movement. So, caste blindness of Indian green politics is also demonstrated the way they have idealized Indian village, culture, tradition, and community. Combined sometimes with the Gandhian perspective, they have often romanticized the Indian villages, regarding it as an embodiment of tradition, an ideal place of homogeneity and harmony, and understanding village community as little republics. Read environmental scholar Madhav Gadgil and Ramchandra Guha. The allure of the village has also provided a powerful medium to challenge urban development and various facets of urban development. Similar is the conception of community by several prominent environmentalists. It could be village community, social community, or others. Environmentalists have often located community as a natural preserve of tradition, as outside modernity, as a symbol of egalitarianism, homogeneity, and cooperation, and as offering an effective challenge to the present developmental model. Various imaginations of community are repeatedly reiterated. Without interweaving it with questions of caste hierarchies and imbalanced shares in nature. Within such perspective, you can very well easily see the viewpoints of several Dalits and anti-caste intellectuals like of Ambedkar, Periyar, Phule, providing a divergent understanding of the village and community. I cannot get into the details here. Take one example. One instance of Ambedkar's account of Indian villages. He presents them as a model of Hindu social organization, a microcosm, the working plant of the Hindu social order, where one could see the Hindu social order in operation in full swing. Controlling habitation, natural resources, and economy of a village is seen as central, not only to the continuity of the Hindu social order, but also to its political and economic standing. Read his very candid conclusion about our so-called glorious Indian village. I am not reading it. So Ambedkar questions the notion of village community as a natural fact, as an innate little republic of Indian civilization, as an untouchable, and from that standpoint, he raised critical concern on the linkages drawn between nature and village. From his earlier writings on the village to his responses to the debate in the Constituent Assembly, Ambedkar highlighted a different, less celebratory theme in Indian thought, conceptualizing the Indian rural landscape not as golden, harmonious and innocent, but as a land of Hindu operation and command, which should not be treated as a basic unit of Indian civilization or constitution. The caste blindness of Indian green movement, making Dalits invisible, is only one part of the story. The other part of the story, equally important, is the positive deployment of caste in understanding environment and nature within the framework of Brahminical Hinduism, which really supports the Indian caste system. I call this phenomena as eco-casteism. I mentioned this eco-casteism even last time when we all were here together. So there are many versions of eco-casteism in contemporary Indian green movement and politics. I will discuss a few today. For example, some of our prominent environmental discourse provide a defense of the caste system. Thus comes the explanation of Kailash Malhotra, a well-known Indian anthropologist, and I quote, "The caste system was actually based on an ancient concept of sustainable development, which disciplined the society by partitioning the use of natural resources according to a specific occupations and caste, and created the right social milieu in which sustainable patterns of resource use were encouraged to emerge," unquote. Or says another, I quote, "The Hindu caste system can be seen as a progenitor of the concept of sustainable development," unquote. Even the otherwise insightful Ecological History of India by Madhav Gadgil and Ramchandra Guha provides, in effect, a functional justification of caste as a system of ecological adaptation. According to them, caste groups bound with each other in supportive relationship had hereditary and specialized occupational functioning. Based on these groups, caste society has also developed a system of diversified resource use that greatly reduced inter-caste competition. Local belief systems, key Hindu gods, and social conventions helped resource conservation and helped evolve a path of cooperation and coexistence. Thus they state, I quote, "It is therefore appropriate to talk of the ecological niche of these various caste groups in terms of the habitats they occupy, the natural resources they utilize, and the relationship they bear to other caste groups with whom they interact." Gadgil and Guha further explain, I quote, "As opposed to the exclusivist approach favored by many monotheist religions such as Islam and Christianity, Hinduism has relied more heavily on an inclusive framework that tries to incorporate rather than reject or convert apparently hostile sects and worldviews. The institutional mechanism for this process of incorporation is, of course, the caste system," unquote. So the evolution of caste has sometimes been defined on the basis of the ecosystem, and the Varna structure has often been called essentially ecological in its logic. The tropic system is defined as the relationship between different forms of life according to their system metabolism, which is derived from the way different classes of organisms convert energy into biomass. It is argued, I quote, and I'm sorry, I'm consciously emphasizing on this part, I quote, "The maintenance of the Varna structure is therefore the key element in the performance of dharma. Given the criticality of this concept to the Brahmanical system, it is interesting that the equilibrium structure appears to be derived from the ecological foundations, foundations that are readily revealed if we look at the Varna equations as a tropic system," unquote. So now read the conclusion of a well-known anthropologist and sociologist, Ashok Das Gupta, about whom I was quoting here. I quote, "It is deeply provocative but nonetheless logical to hold that the evolution of untouchability was in an ecological sense something of the master stroke which enhanced the competitive advantage of those populations that adopted it. Thus would have developed a specialized population of decomposers, scavengers, and so on. This, in our view, is the ecological rationale for the adaptive system of untouchability, the latent principle in the Varna system," unquote. So there are many versions of others have equated caste with traditional indigenous knowledge system, which can very well combine nature, human, supernature. I'm leaving that part. Some environmentalists actually attempt to renew ideas of traditional caste-based occupations in the name of environment to make them newly applicable to contemporary needs and concern. Modern toilets, sanitation, and sewage are condemned as Western systems, inappropriate for India. This is combined with a suggestion that an ideal village should have perfect sanitation of the traditional kind for disposing human waste. Ecological societies are those where toilets are dry, where waste is removed daily and composted. The lesson is, I quote this. So, eco-casteism, an ecological determinant of caste, provides a rationalization and justification of caste system through nature. Caste identity becomes a key organizing framework for environmental thought and action. Dominant caste can validate their power through such a conception. Eco-casteism, as propagated and practiced presently, combines with what I call eco-organicism and eco-naturalism. I will just briefly explain. So, eco-organicism is a so-called and much celebrated Indian approach to nature, where environment is understood as divine, cosmic, and intrinsic, conforming to the laws of nature. Society is viewed as natural, based on natural principles, whereby modernity, science, industry, technology are described as Western, materialist, consumerist, and thus unnatural and uncultured. In such understanding, Indian environment is believed to be under threat from outside forces. Therefore, protection of environment is synonymous with protection of Indian culture, tradition, nation, and here Indian culture consists comprehensively of our family, our values, our faiths, our rituals, our ceremonies, social systems, and everything. This binary of Indian and Western offers a wealth of environmental literature in which Indianism, Brahmanism, and Hinduism are enmeshed to offer many straightforward solutions. I'm not getting into the various examples, that will take a lot of time. So then after eco-organicism, the other version of eco-casteism is eco-naturalism, is the coupling of environmental protection with the protection of life in its natural order. According to this view, humans have wrongly considered themselves as above nature, whereas they should be viewed as in nature, which is rich, permanent, and cultural, and often provide national values to guide human actions. There can be several versions of eco-naturalism along with eco-organicism and eco-casteism. For example, nature is above all, to whom humans must submit. Nature and its teaching give a model to govern politics and economy. An ecological society is run by nature's rule and cycle. There are ecological communities and societies based on certain tradition, culture, religion, and nationality. We must return to nature. So, eco-naturalism uses nature to affirm the supremacy of natural order in major spheres of our life, food, animal, livelihood, which is many a times synonymous with conservative Hindu Brahminical belief. For example, just take one example, which is very current also, the food. Food is here part of the ultimate reality, Brahmin. It is culturally given along with the designated social ritual phases, according to which multiple schemes of food classification establish rules about appropriate eating and feeding. Within this framework, I quote, writing by environmentalist Ranchor Prime, who is also a main activist in Vrindavan and WWF and so on and so forth. I quote, the bull represents dharma, moral principles, and cow represents the earth. It is a tragedy that the modern society, oh, it's here. So I don't need to read. So the slaughterer, butcherer, nature's punishment, all we see so much in our contemporary India. So purity and pollution of our body, touch, taste, space, place, people are the key markers of caste, creating essential qualities and differences within and outside the nature escapes. Nature itself cannot determine the identity of a place, but caste creates a natural essence and ambience to establish power relations and social order. Thus, we have vast landscapes of purity and pollution in India that maintain strict lines for caste identity, dominance, and exclusion, from sacred groves to natural water bodies, from village to city. These demarcation between cultured and uncultured, holy and unholy, natural and unnatural, are so alive and active through natural and social dispositions. The caste of places naturalized in different ways. Boundaries of villages are identified with caste. Areas of pond, well, rivers are marked by caste. Recently, Ravi asked me, landfill sites have caste. So how landfill sites have caste? So the different demarcations. So thus, there is a spatial aspect of issues of power, hierarchy, and inequality. So, and this whole pure and polluted, and the way it creates different demarcations through the use of nature, that is the main point. In the above context, I have some other propositions to make here on the interrelationship between caste, nature, and Dalit. We all know nature is the natural world, considered as natural and universal, common and applicable to all, endowed with wide, unaccountable varieties of human species, animals, plants, land, consisting of all things, including us. We also know that caste is a divisive, hierarchical human world, considered as constructed and distinct historical and social entity, unique to India and based on a system of stratification and division of society. We understand the diversity, multiplicity, diversity, and elasticity in the meaning of nature and environment. As I also mentioned in the beginning, we are also aware of the various historicity, complexity, peculiarity in the theory and practice of caste in India. My hypothesis is that caste and nature are intimately interwoven in India. We need to see this interconnectedness from a Dalit lens. And I very much, if we see from the lens of Dalit, question the concept of any kind of universal environmentalism. My fieldwork and overall understanding suggest that Dalit experiences and narratives constantly underline their everyday ecological burdens in a marked hierarchical order. The various kind of memories about land animate caste anxieties around bondage, labor, blood, forced labor, and so on and so forth. In dry regions of Maharashtra, Gujarat, Rajasthan, Dalits must often sacrifice their lives to recharge ponds, rivers, and wells. Practiced still very recently. From village to city and temple to school, caste metaphors of pollution, impurity, and dirt dominate places and spaces through imaginaries of dangers posed by the presence of Dalits. Forest can be a heaven or a hell for Dalits. Nature, in this manner, when gets entwined with fear and violence, horror and hardship, bloodbath and war, bondage and hard labor, that makes environmental experience of anybody different and distinct. So in this context of green politics, their caste blindness, eco-casteism, eco-organicism, and eco-naturalism, how do I see Dalit relationship with the environment? Again, very briefly. We now know very much that Dalit intellectual thought has historically been a touchstone for Indian politics and civil rights. However, it also has much to say on our relationship to nature. Here, I don't wish to claim in any fashion that Dalit attitudes to environment are somehow better or valorize their standpoint. That is not the point here. Some Dalit intellectuals have argued that since Dalits have been closer to nature because of their labor and other thing, therefore they have more cultural and ecological vitality and creativity. Dalits' original environmental, technological, scientific, and productive knowledge has been invoked to claim their role and contribution in all spheres of life in a post-Hindu India. However, in my understanding, Dalit naturalism of this kind or romanticism can also be associated with a kind of eco-casteism and caste essentialism. I'm not getting into the details here. I can very well sell my book here so that you can read some of these details in my book. So the interrelationship between Dalit and environment is certainly, as I mentioned, complex and conflict-ridden. Anthropocentric or biocentric views of environment are primarily based on human experiences. However, the experiences of an untouchable or an outcast or a bonded laborer, often considered less than a human being, are not compatible with these binaries of human nature. They challenge us to understand the meaning and implications of nature for those living on the margin of human existence. Dalits have a diverse environmental history and sensibility. They have distinct environmental memory and language. It's also true that they have generally articulated this under the rubric of social as opposed to explicitly environmental. It may at times be expressed more from the margin than the mainstream, from the local than the national, and be raw rather than refined. Shayad angreji mein na ho, bahut zyada bhashaon mein ho. For example, when Chamars of North India launched some decades ago a very well-known Nara Maveshi movement to shed their polluting caste-based occupations, they had also concern at time about their labor, their livelihood, animal and environment. The emergence of land issues in 1960s and 70s was aimed at revisiting the issue of access, distribution, conservation, continuity, and various memories around land. Such sensibility and knowledge has been evident historically in anti-caste thinking and activism. One of the key principles of Ambedkar, Phule, and Periyar was how to deal with village, land, agriculture, water, and forest. Mind you, if you go through the Ambedkar voluminous writing, there are wealth and wealth of his writing on forest, water, land, agriculture, and various of those issues. There is a wealth of Dalit eco-literature that I'm working now on, Dalit nature writing, poems, painting, stories, music, folklore, coming from diverse regions and community. I have tried to capture from three, four regions. Dalit myths and legends like Mayabel and Jasma, Dina and Bhadri, Eklabya and Kabir, Kabir, again, one of the fascinating, underline their dreams and desire for ecological belonging against their suffering, sacrifice, and alienation. They have their different gods and goddesses, pujas and festivals, surrounding with tank system, water, soil, field, technical knowledge, to celebrate and highlight a different aspect of natural element against various odds. Dalits can be active ecological agents in their own right, and their understandings of nature and ethics, planning and management of resources are many times intertwined with narratives of social justice. So combining snapshots from different historical period and geographical region, one can bring out Dalit ecological insights in which the themes of labor, land, water, agriculture, place, myth, music, and social justice come out prominently. Attempts at universalization of a space in historical, mythical, and contemporary terms represent a major trend in Dalit thinking and action on environment, the universalization of a space. The notion of new commons, which I will be focusing in the last part of my presentation. So now coming to the last part of my presentation, and I hope I'm not... So my talk will be, I think, incomplete without giving you a quick shot of the Dalit thinking or imagination about environment. And here I will be talking about this person, Dashrath Manjhi. Have you heard of Dashrath Manjhi? You must have seen. I will just come out and give you some slides of Bollywood. Who carved a road through the mountain in Gaya district of Bihar. For 22 years, day and night, it is said in memory of his wife who died after a serious injury inflicted inside the mountain. A man who died in 2007 at the age of 78 had independently and single-handedly brought down a 360 feet long, 20 feet high hill and created a 16 feet wide pass in place of an almost impenetrable common natural hilly space. Manjhi has been vividly described as the mountain man, the superman, the hill man of Bihar, the poor man's Shah Jahan, the modern day Bhagirath, a record holder in 1999 Limca Books, well-known Bollywood filmmaker Ketan Mehta made a feature film on Dashrath Manjhi named Manjhi the Mountain Man. That was released in 2015. Film actor Amir Khan visited the village and family of Dashrath Manjhi in 2014 for his TV show Satmev Jayate 2. He was symbolically made the Chief Minister of Bihar for a day by the then and present Chief Minister of the state, Nitish Kumar. Upon his death, he was given the state funeral by the Bihar government. Such descriptions about Manjhi abound that would tell you various aspects of his existence. However, one can see Dashrath Manjhi from an environmental lens and how a poor, a Dalit, a landless, a Kamiya, a bonded laborer, perceive and act upon commons, the common property resources, and how it could be different and distinct from others. Manjhi equated life with nature. I quote, "Life is nature, a moving, breathing thing. It transforms from one form to another. Transformation means going beyond our form," unquote. Environmental values and interventions, as I said, are not always universal. It is characterized by the issues of gender, caste, ethnicity, race, and culture. I established the importance of seeing Dashrath Manjhi as an environmentalist with a difference, even when he was never been a part of the mainstream environmentalism. Commons, we all know, which are often natural resources, land, forest, water, mountain, groves, air, earth, have been a touchstone for different kind of green politics in varied countries. So I will not get into the various definition and importance common property resources. So coming to the state of Bihar, district Gaya, block Atari, village Gehlor, Dasrat Manji was born, lived and died in his place. Gehlor has been an isolated village because of the high hill range spreading from Bodh Gaya to Rajgir and blocking it up front. The laborers had to trek through different terrains for hours to reach their working fields and nearby markets. Children had to walk at least 8 kilometers to reach their school and the nearest block towns. Basic medical services were 70, 80 kilometers away. After Manji's accomplishment, the distance between Gehlor and his area has reduced to only 13 kilometers, and a road within the heart of the mountain easily connects the village with the field, school, hospital, and other everyday destinations. There are rich and varied accounts as to why and how Manji decided to cut through the mountain and carve a road. Manji was, as I mentioned, a bonded laborer in the village, and he was from the Musahar caste, one of the downtrodden, untouchable, ex-untouchable caste. And as bonded labor, he had to work hard throughout the year, tending to the landlords, land, households, animals, fuel woods, and whatever else the owners asked him to do. One day at noontime, Manji's wife, Faguni, was bringing food and water to his workplace. It was a hot, dry day, and Faguni, walking through the mountain slopes, got seriously injured. When he came to know of his wife's injury, he could not take her to the hospital. Faguni endured great pain, died after a few weeks without getting timely treatment. After some time, Manji sold his coats to buy a hammer and a borer, his sole instrument for breaking the mountain. He began breaking the mountain and undertook it with painstaking regularity, which lasted, I told you, for 22 years. He was a bonded laborer, so he had to first fulfill his duties to the landlord, and then every day he headed towards the mountain for a few hours with his instrument. His labor was ridiculed, and he was called mad, insane, crazy, but that could never take away his willpower. Manji was asked by the Environment and Forest Department to stop making holes in the mountain, as the government claimed property rights over the common property resources. He was arrested for a few days. So why Manji? The hill and bushes were also inhabited by wild animals, dogs, bears, leopards. As Kamiya and laborers, they had to constantly deal with dangers, attacks, injuries, and loss due to these animals. Constant struggle with animals for their survival. At times, he had ambivalent attitude towards land, forest, and mountain. His feelings were at times negative, as he was forced to perform such labor on land, forest, and mountain, which was humiliating, back-breaking, and life-risking. He inhabited a natural world of dry land, hard mountain, and fearful forest, and a social world of subjugation, hierarchy, and exclusion. The interaction between the physical and the social shaped his views on nature and commons. Gehlor had a compelling presence for the villagers, especially for Musahars, as it isolated them from the world. Manji once said, it's there, the mountain is right there by me, by my village, and within my heart. We cannot live at the bottom of the mountain. Instead, we have to be on the way up on the mountain." Unquote. Narratives of labor coupled with environment abound around Dasrath Manji. Baba Dasrath remarked, "If you have to cut down the mountain, you will have to be 6 feet taller than the mountain. If you have to measure up the depth of the sea, you have to be somewhat deeper than the sea itself. Real wealth is the desire of the soul." he went on, I quote, "The mountain did not appear to me as tall as it is made out to be. Nobody is taller than a human being." Dying of cancer, Manji still wanted to devote himself now to working on the river water and save the village from the agonies of drought and floods that comes there every year. Living on his deathbed, he was saying, I quote, "Mountains and rivers both have to be changed to keep us alive. Road is not my end. I want to travel through a new path," unquote. So Dasrath Manji, his tireless effort, his labor and life around the common can be understood in an ecological framework with natural, social, and physical meanings. The unsurpassable mountain was a constant reminder of his degraded status as he negotiated with it on an everyday basis to reach his workplace as a kamiya, as a bonded laborer. It symbolized many personal losses and pains. And yet, working on the mountain, he considered it this his very own, his common space, which he could appropriate, carve, and break through his labor. As a Musar, he was an environmental other in the village with almost no rights over the common forest and land resources of the mountain, in which caste discrimination and unequal resource distribution was paramount. He was deeply uncomfortable with the forms and practices personified in the commons, as they carried within them exclusion, fear, isolation, bondage, pain, thirst, hunger, and many more, and caste injustices. Even before the articulation of formal Indian environmental politics, Dasrath Manji could be seen as a harbinger of a distinct ecological sensibility. He desired, loved, worked, and lived for a new commons, unbound by the burdens of the old. And here, Manji's effort represents an attempt at universalization of a space and commons. And this new commons is something that could be a project of the future. So my final point, that in my presentation today, I have taken some fragmentary examples, and that too very briefly. This talk or the research on this topic is an attempt to see or understand the Indian green politics through a Dalit lens, through which we may able to glean a new ecological universe, a visible Dalit environmental public space, which is often outside the dominant environmental frame, but is nonetheless embedded in Dalit ecological understandings. Dalit environmentalism or Dalit ecological sensibility is not any kind of a finished or refined project. I'm not here flag hosting about the Dalit environmental project. However, its relative invisibility is also a sign of the upper caste habitat which surrounds us all over. By exploring different subject formation in relation to environment, as well as by opening the public secrets of Indian environmentalhood or Indian secular environmentalhood, I attempt to bring the readings and understandings of caste, Dalit, and green politics together. At different points and location, explorations of interrelationship between gender and nature, between race and nature, between ethnicity and culture, between gender and caste, have, we all know, opened up new political possibilities. And I hope by bringing the caste and nature, we can again push that boundaries further. Thank you.
Thank you, Mukul, for an amazing talk, which I'm still unpacking in my head so while we start discussing this. But just my first thoughts, it's like when I was growing up, I was confronted with this idea of gender and relooking the world. And similarly, the trajectory you now invite us to think through, again, unpacks and upturns the world, which I assumed to be something, and it you can unpack every category which we assume as a universal category and recategorize and rethink about it. Only I'm unable to say how to rethink about it and how do I imbibe the experience which you are suggesting through which this rethinking needs to be done. And where do I get that experience from to rethink that? Where do I get the resources to rethink what you're suggesting intellectually for us to rethink? So I think it's a radical proposition which you propose. But just as the first question which came to me is this. If we, like in the idea of race, which much more has been written about race and nature than about caste, the race-based politics is very rife and very, very present in mainstream environmental thinking in the West. This is not the case here. You're one of the few scholars who've been working on it. So my question which comes to me, when we're confronted with this, well, universal idea of science and climate change, for example, how would when we think of this, okay, the term crisis we can contest and use, how would we think of this moment if we rethink it in terms of a Dalit imagination of nature? What would this reconstruction mean? How can we start thinking about these global problems from as we try to understand the different axes through which nature has been produced and maybe the questions which the production of this nature has brought to the fore and constructed the world in a certain way, but also led to the moment where certain kinds of what we call the moments of crisis have come about in which everything gets impacted. So how do we start thinking about this radical proposition which you are presenting to us?
So there are various layers of getting into this issue of taking caste and Dalit into our green politics and environmental politics. Of course, we all, I think you might be agreeable to this point that all these issues, whether it's a common or climate change or forest or water, if you see from either gender or from race perspective, it opens up layers and layers of complexities. And people you have rightly, and I also mentioned that it came through the gender lens and race and ethnicity, but not much through the lens of caste. So, to get into the issue of understanding caste in the realm of Indian green politics, we seriously need to first understand the overall Brahminical conception of nature and environment that deeply percolates in our overall understanding of nature and environment. And how do we construct and deconstruct the Brahminical thought? Because we all, it's part and parcel of our everyday life and experience in terms of our cultural universe, our behaviors, our practices, our ethics. The first beginning point that understanding and deconstructing the Brahminical mode of thinking and practice that also percolates deeply in our environmental politics. Just to give you an example. It's no harm to build the environmental politics, and all over the environmental politics has been built over the issues of myths and symbols and various kind of cultural constructions. But have you ever heard in any of our prominent environmental discourse, I haven't heard. If somebody has heard, I will be happy to get the reference. The mention of various bhakti or Sufi tradition in constructing the environment politics. I come from North India, so I work on Kabir, and I'm more familiar of Kabir. But in different region, there are different Kabirs and different. So why so? Why we have been able to construct Ram or Krishna and various Hindu gods and goddesses as the symbol of our environmental tradition and culture, and there is no harm in constructing that is our cultural resource, but why not Kabir? So, and that shows the domination of certain religious texts, religious practices. So that is one way that how do you understand the culture and the Brahminical culture, and in terms of understanding the caste. Second is that the way, and it's a lot to learn from the gender academia and the academia who has worked on the issue of race. The way they have enriched the environmental movement and seeing the environmental movement, each and every threat from the lens of gender, from the lens of Afro-Americans, that should be effort. That when we talk about climate change, and I'm really sorry that this effort hasn't been started, that how do we get the caste and Dalit perspective on the issue of climate change? The way, suppose, Afro-Americans, you have rightly mentioned, deconstructed effectively the whole notion of wilderness. That was the key element of American environmental politics. And through their memories, through their experiences, tried to question the entire notion of wilderness as the environmental environmentalism. So second thing is that we need to learn from interdisciplinary, the way gender and race became a key category. Today, no environmental discourse is complete without, but why not? So the second point is that we need to actually take into this interdisciplinary approach. And third thing is that to understand many marginal community in terms of environment and green politics, we need to go beyond our conventional sources of researching, writing, connecting. Suppose if you want to do much research on caste, Dalit, and Indian environmentalism, the traditional archival source and the way we write history and do history is really insufficient. You need to get into the myths, your folklore, various kind of unconventional traditions of history writing. The third thing is that getting beyond the traditional way of working, researching, and practicing. So I could see these three things. And there's a lot more to do, actually, in this field. And how to connect with this local to global issue, from the struggle over commons to the issue of global climate change, I have no simple answers to offer. Because it's also true that when you are looking for these environmental imagination from marginal community, it's equally true that it's very much anchored in the, at times, in the discourse of modernity, development. And the way those aspirations and expectations also drive them towards their various pursuit. So understanding these complexities of development, modernity, environmental imagination, coupled with various global issues that you have rightly mentioned, that is a big challenge. I was speaking in Ashoka the other day, and there one of the very important questions was that how do you explain the Dalit environmental imagination in the context of their developmental aspiration, which is very much there, very much, very obvious. So not a simple answer. So, yeah.
So in that sense, if you then uncategorize the environmental movement from its classical, the nature of the movement itself would change. It's not just the inclusion into a particular Narmada Bachao movement or into a particular Tehri Dam, anti-dam movement, the nature of the movement itself would be different. It's not just an inclusion issue. It's just what you are fighting for, how you are, what you're trying to preserve and what you're trying to keep. Would that be correct into saying that? That yes. Such a radical transformation would be suggested.
I don't know radical or not radical, okay. Because one is very careful now but using these words. Sure. Because, not in terms of any, the way state is clamping down, but overall the various meaning, my previous work actually suggested me to be very careful about using this. So when I was studying green and saffron, that how many prominent green movements get into the language and discourse of Hindu nationalistic conservative politics, whether it's a Tehri or Anna Hazare and so on and so forth. Anyway, so that is a different topic. No, I'm not questioning anybody because Indian environmental academia, activism, practitioner is so rich and something to be proud of, and we all come from that tradition. But still, I think that there is a traditional way of environmental thinking, or traditional environmentalism, or traditional environmental writing, which certainly represented by Ram Guha, Madhav Gadgil, etc., focusing on community, rights over resources, impact of colonial rule on country like us, and upsurge of various environmental movement and so on and so forth. But there is a need to, within quote, radically transform that way of environmental thinking, discourse, research, and practice, in which issues of development, issues of ethnicity, caste, Dalit, have you ever seen any study on Indian environmental movement and Muslims? I haven't seen. If you see any time, please let me know. You have to, I think, disaggregate some of the traditional environmental discourse and movement, and in that way understand and then aggregate the way Ambedkar tried to do in the Dalit politics, which is now in serious fragmentation. That is again a different story. So that is the, I think, challenge.
Just before I open it up, you had mentioned about Ambedkar's writing on water, forests. Could you mention something about what he was saying for the...
No, it's a fascinating that we have such a wealth of literature on Ambedkar, internationally, nationally, so many scholarly work on Ambedkar, but very few work, that is first point, that how Ambedkar dealt with the issue of land, water, agriculture, science, technology, so on and so forth. You might disagree. Because Ambedkar was also one of the initiators of this whole River Valley project. The first Damodar Valley project came through the initiative of Ambedkar. So fine. But that was not the only one. I would say that one of the first environmental movement of India came through the Maharashtra struggle on water, which of course was has been understood in terms of civil rights and rights over the water body. But if you go through Ambedkar's speeches given during the Mahar Satyagraha, it's a fascinating account of water and lake and how does it look like. And how people travel through water and go and collect. And so it's not only the, so the first point is that trying to go through not only Ambedkar, Phule, Periyar, which is one big chapter in my book, and that work is of course very incomplete because you need a very longer time. There could be an environmental tradition in the writing of anti-caste intellectuals, including Ambedkar. You can take Periyar, Phule, and others in this category. That is one. Second thing, certainly that if you take Ambedkar into account, the issue of access, ownership, who owns, who decides the question of natural resources, that come very prominently. In the specific context of forest rights, land rights, water. So that is a another notable feature. Then third, Ambedkar dealt also in detail with the issue of science, technology, waste, development, that all, and that could be problematic at times, that you can certainly criticize some of the views, but you can also find many of his arguments dealing with the issue of wealth, the humanity, the human person, how one should deal with the technology in a long run manner. So my coupled with my first point that when many of us have tried to conceptualize Gandhi, Nehru, even to the extent of Indira Gandhi, from Mahesh Rangarajan to Jairam Ramesh, seeing them to from environmental lens, why was not Ambedkar or Phule or Periyar or Nagaraj, or for that matter, many other Dalit thinkers and writers have been conceptualized from the environmental lens. So that is the point. So it's a wealth of literature, many contrasting views on development, modernity, science, technology, so on and so forth.
Questions?
This through the Dalit lens. Could you elaborate on that, please?
There have been a study about Narmada Bachao Andolan from the perspective of caste and Dalit, overall study in which what I have quoted, the lack of participation of Dalit, the deletion of issues of caste, the dominance of landowners within the course of movement, those aspects have also been highlighted prominently. So I see Narmada Bachao Andolan personally as a researcher in a very high esteem. A movement that have created an alternative discourse of development and so on and so forth. The point here is that even within those heroic environmental movement, what kind of a space do you find for issues of caste, Dalit, lower caste people, their land rights, their issues of access and so on and so forth. So there has been critical perspective on these movements, trying to see the movement in a comprehensive manner. I have done some studies on Narmada as a journalist, not as a researcher in past, but I have done very deep research work on Sundar Lal Bhaguna and his anti-Tehri Dam movement. Surprisingly, I also found similar kind of conclusion because this Narmada study came out recently in the past 3-4 years. I can give you the reference if you want. There is a detail. But when I was doing a study on Sundar Lal Bhaguna 6-7 years ago, without knowing the Narmada dynamics, I could also find the same kind. So that means there is, not consciously, there is some sort of a pattern regarding the issue of caste and Dalit within these very, very heroic, glorious, noteworthy environmental movement in India. In spite of their various, suppose that you would also find on the issue of Hindu nationalism, that you will, those are the spot, worrisome spot. So leave that but one, because that will divert the topic entirely. So that is the point.
Can I ask a quick follow-up?
Please.
I'm curious if we can attribute the responsibility to someone or something in such a case. Like, for example, in such an activism by Medha Patkar, is she responsible for the lack of inclusion? Is she complicit in there? Or is it that the kind of social framework that she is working with, that itself is playing a part?
Yes, I would go along with your second formulation that the kind of social formation, the kind of people we are built in through our own cultural background, and Ravi was some time back before this seminar was mentioning that how caste is ingrained in our everyday life, in our home, in our families, and so on and so forth. So the point here is that environmental movement is not only about trees and not only about forest. I think it's also about the way we would like humanity to build all around, the way we would like to build human nature relationship and human relationship. That is the way one would like to see the environmental movement. And if environmental movement is also getting caught of the various pitfalls and fault lines in our society, whether in terms of caste or in terms of Hindu nationalism or in terms of othering the other religious community, then what is this all about? Then, of course, Anna Hazare can always claim to build the ideal village in Ahmednagar. But what is this ideal village for? If that ideal village get submerged in the politics of Hindu nationalist authoritarian regime, then what for this water? This is my, what for this water and forest?
I want to ask, you know, when there is an opposition from anybody of the meat eating, then one will assume that this is coming from the Hindu right or the nationalist. But when it comes that, when the statement comes from the UNESCO or the United Nations body, that meat, commercial meat production and the meat eating is contributed lot in the global heating and the climate change and everything. This is the, they have blamed the meat eating or the meat, commercial meat production to the environmental change and the climate change. So how the, you know, the green bodies, the green people who drink wine and eat meat, or the Dalits also eat meat, how they will react that this is the meat eating is the blame for the environmental change?
Can you, I was not clear.
He's talking about that.
I'm sorry, I was not.
That if, for example, if environmentalists or Dalit eats meat, and meat eating is, the UN says, not only the Hindu right, but the UN says it's bad for the, for, similar to the climate change question I asked you, sir. Then how do you negotiate these differences in terms of what is the environment which it's bad for, and what is this then, this differentiated approach to the production of, I'm paraphrasing it.
They have United Nations or UNESCO, they have come up with the official statement, the environmental change in the climate, the global heating, has that has come because of the main of the...
What constitutes good environment is...
Look, it's a very different kind of question. I haven't thought about it, that this environmental, international environmental organization or UN body suggesting what is the environmental good and what is the environmental bad, and how would we take that environmental good and bad into our account for a better or green future. That is, it could be, look, I would say that it depends on individuals and communities and how to negotiate with environmental discourses coming from, leave from environmental organization, but from various sources. For example, there is a very, you must be aware about this developmental debate in the context of climate change, which is a bone of contention between developing countries, developed world. There is a view among developed world about how should we be developing, There is a view about the environmental space that developing world should be entitled for. So how do we negotiate? It's a very complex negotiation, which I don't think I can answer how that negotiation.
If I may just propose a line of inquiry into your question, as I'm thinking, that maybe meat is not as universal category as what the UN is making it out to be. You know, there are many kinds of meat. There's also the industrial farmed meat. There's also the livestock meat. There's also the daily fishermen. So to equate meat as any universalization of category creates a problem in which a differentiated way of looking at something finds it hard to respond to something which we are actually want to fight against the universalization of categories, and then be presented with a, you know, so maybe it's the same question about climate change, that what about climate justice when we talk of climate change, you know, so when we say that does a Dalit have to respond the same way to a New Yorker to climate change, it's an unfair question to ask also. So maybe the justice and the universalization could be a inquiry. I'm just proposing it. I'm not answering your question. I'm proposing it as an access to rethink that the UN bodies are not ununiversal also. But of course, the question of what constitutes science, what's the nature of data, what constitutes a crisis, what is the planetary change, these are very complex questions, because you can go to Trumpism in one way, by its complete denial, and you can go to actions which are universal, which actually don't take into account differential impacts.
I'm very happy with Ravi's response. So, much better than mine.
Just two brief things. One was an annotation to the Narmada Bachao questions, based really on very peripheral involvement as a student activist a long time ago. We have to look at the material basis of each one of these movements, and I think the real challenge for NBA was, across the long arc of whoever was going to be affected by the rising water, to bring together middle castes with small holdings and tribal communities. So I think that was the real reconciliation that was attempted. So it was strongly based on who was going to lose their land. So the landless and Dalits unfortunately didn't come into that. This we now see as a deficit, but at that point it was important to build certain kinds of bridges. I hate to say it, but I think that was really the calculation then. Yeah. So that would be a brief annotation to these questions, because otherwise we get trapped in personality issues. The second point was more really a question to you, Mukul. There is a very, very powerful strand within Dalit politics which is premised on the metropolis. And you cited Ambedkar's famous critique of the Indian village, which says that the Indian village is pretty much the nest of all evil, and it is. So following from that, I think there's a strand in Dalit politics which embraces the urban scenario as a site of emancipation and of self-refashioning, if you will. So I wonder if that has something to do with the fact that, I'm going out on a limb here, I don't have empirical evidence, but does that perhaps explain why there isn't a Dalit environmentalist movement of equal strength? I mean, we know, for instance, that people like Amitanshu Acharya, others have been working on collecting evidence of a Dalit imaginary about nature, about rivers, an alternative notion of the sacred even. But why does that not get articulated in such a powerful and visible way? Or is it that we don't know about this?
It's a very, very, I think, good insight about various strand of Dalit imagination. Village and the way they understand village could be one, cities, education, English education, mobility, along with all these things, modernity, development. So historically marginal community going through different kind of transformation and change, coupled with different influences, making this entire issue very heavy at times. You can try to catch hold of some strands of Dalit imagination, etc., etc. That certainly is a task for researcher and should be taken up. But along with those strands, you will find various currents of development, modernity, mobility, migration, and so. So I would not say that because of the great fascination towards city and city being seen as the savior and so on and so forth is one crucial reason. I would say that it's a complexity of various happening and their intersection at a particular point of time. This whole notion of cities actually and Dalit's take on cities is much true for states like Maharashtra, Gujarat, Karnataka, which have been progressing well. But if you get into the north and states like Odisha and so on and so forth, there you will find different kind of current, where there are, city is not giving much promise. So there is still holding very dearly and closely with issues of land, agriculture, somewhat traditional occupation, trying to transform the, suppose if you get into this entire belt of UP, Kanpur, etc., where they have been traditionally bound with this occupation of animals and dead skins, you will find those occupation getting transformed and getting modernized through the agency of Dalit. So there you will find, not the cities, but the different. So I would say that combination of various complex factors. But you are right that cities in the writing of various Dalits still hold a very great place of liberation and imagination. And there has been very less questioning within the Dalit writing about the complexities of urban development, cities, urbanism, and so on and so forth. So yeah. So I have no, I think, neat answer to your query. It's a combination of various factors.
Okay. Hi. So I have a couple of thoughts on things that have generally been said around. So please feel free to agree with me, disagree with me, elaborate so that I know better, whatever. So one was with the whole UN thing. So the United Nations is a pan-governmental body. They are going to be, like, the messaging that they do is going to differ very, very much, and it is going to be biased. Say, for instance, this whole meat thing. The details of the information that have gone around, say, for instance, it is industrialization that would cause the massive carbon emissions, because unlike your natural process of gathering or raising cattle, industrialization starts from the very process of like genetically modifying the seed so that it is grown in a certain way with all the standards that have to be followed, because then that goes, because that, like, you know, gets distributed through a mass distribution channel, goes through all the food networks, your McDonald's and stuff like that. So In communities where, because of high meat consumption and because of an accepted way of life where, you know, you buy things either pre-packaged or from a different source, that's where the emissions come from. And the UN is going to tell individuals that stop using straws and, you know, stop consuming meat. But their messaging is not going to be industrialization of meat has to stop. If you have to do it sustainable, like, that is not going to be their messaging. So personally, I feel that is why nothing that comes from, you know, international organizations can, I mean, it's great for credibility and it's great to take seriously in terms of details, but I don't think it should be internalized that much without realizing that there is a big screen that, you know, we're not looking at. Then the second thing was with respect to how you would put together, you know, the priority of we want to, like, if you're focusing on the environmental crisis, how are you going to focus on other social issues? Now, I feel like right now, because of the urgency in general, that is bound to happen because, say, for instance, now the seasons are changing. Now, since the seasons are changing, all the farming patterns that basically enabled human society to stop traveling around looking for food because they could finally predict and grow stuff, since those seasons are changing, means our whole understanding of food is changing. And if because of policies and because of the environment crisis and because of news being highly selective in what they want to tell, if the people who are actually doing the growing and the actual sowing, that is the peasants and the landless laborers, if there are going to be no generations further on who are going to be doing this, then where is the food going to come from? So it has to go back to food. It has to go back to who's actually doing all this. So those are my personal opinions on general things that have been said today. And it was really insightful, so thanks.
It's fine. You have. I agree with your skepticism about the UN and how far it can go, of course, because these are government-run bodies. And I just want to encourage not only you, but me, all of us, into thinking about what we assume to be true. Is it true? Is it true that settled agriculture solved the problem of food? Is it true that nomadic ways of life did not serve a certain other purpose? Is it true that food is a generic category? When we say we grow more food and it changes, that there's more food availability. What about food access? And what kind of food are we growing? And is it also not true that some kinds of food have caused more havoc in ecological systems? The farm burning of stubble in around Delhi is one example of what certain kind of seeding windows do. So I'm just suggesting that these questions are really so complex, and they have been important and key things which have happened, which have led to downstream impacts. But when we propose certain things, and the other question is also when we universalize science, we have to be careful, I think. It's my view that, firstly, what is the kind of data you're looking at through which you are making these universal claims? And what are the questions we are asking to get to that kind of data through which we make the absolute idea of what science proposes as something which is universally applicable? Having worked in the idea of standards personally for a long time, environmental standards, differentiation in health standards are the main things through which we think of what something needs to be, what food needs to conform to, what air needs to conform to, what water needs to conform to as our standards, that how clean or undirty it is. But where does the data for that come from? And what kind of vulnerabilities we take in whose health are we really considering? You know, so a standard might be a certain standard, but may not be standard for the person with the least nutritional access, in a sense. So I just want to say that we have to be a little careful when we accept grand narratives about how the world has come to be today. And when we start unpacking those narratives, we find that we'll have to unpack the histories of how we come to this certain understanding and how we have been bought into what has brought us to this point, whatever that point is. That can also be questioned, because the us is not also universal. We are not a universal us. You know, he's saying there's another universal, there's another category, and the feminists told us in the 70s onwards that there's another category. And of course, one can ask him, when you put these two categories together, what happens to Dalit women and nature? I think we come to a completely different place.
So we just have to be very careful about what we start believing in so easily. I mean, we have to be in a constant state of inquiry and questioning, because we are really in a place of mass messaging today. And we have to be really careful, I feel. I agree with you fully, but I'm just thinking that as citizens, to be really critical in our thinking now. We have to do a lot of hard work, I think.
Thank you. That was a really illuminating talk, because I hadn't considered the idea of Dalit ecology. Like, I can understand, say, tribal ecology, because I'm familiar with, say, your Niyamgiri or other such fights that we do know about. When you gave us the example of Manji, I wasn't quite sure what the Dalit aspect of identity was coming through in that. Like, for example, there is this one other environmentalist called Timakka. She is from Karnataka. And I think this year she was given the Padma Shri for planting some 8,000 trees or something. The only time her Dalit identity came up was when it was politicians who wanted to play it up and give her awards for that, which is why she was like, oh, I reject my caste identity. I don't have examples of Dalit environmentalists, so is there some direction that you could push me towards in terms of finding out more about it?
One of my broader point was that if one would like to understand, within quotes, Dalit environmentalism, though this term should be used very carefully, as I always say that it's not a finished or that kind of a project or category, then certainly it's not there in the mainstream, which I say that one will have to look at the margin. Suppose if you, and when I give example of this movement to shed traditional occupation in a state called UP, when I give example of various land rights movement where Dalits have taken big initiative, there one would like to locate the environmental strand. Because those movements or initiatives were not only confined about livelihood. They were also raising questions about purity, pollution, animal, conservation, who will conserve animal, who will not, who will deal with their bodies, who will not. So there were various kind of, how do you structure environmental issues? How do you begin seeing the environmental issues beyond the conventional environmental parameter? That is the point. If you want to locate the Dalit environment, suppose, right, that you are not finding the example of Dasarath Manji convincing. Fair enough. If you have questions, but why Dasarath Manji started looking at the common, which was there for everybody, and started seeing that common in a different manner? Why, along with Dasarath Manji, the people of his caste, low caste people, started rallying around with Dasarath Manji to transform that common, which was there for forest, which was there for preservation, which were the property of forest and environment department? Why? Of course, one could see that it was all about the wife and wife's pain. But when you then dissect his various sayings, his work, his life, then you start making out the environmental meaning out of it. My response to your query, that certainly we can try to locate various kind of the environmental initiative and movements in different part of country, in their movements, in their writing. But there is not a grand narrative in the contemporary India about Dalit environmental imagination. It's in the bits and pieces, it's in their memories, it's scattered here, there, everywhere. One need to actually get into that mode to understand Dalit environmental imagination. If we try to locate something like Narmada Bachao Andolan, led by some Dalit or Dalit outfit, then I think that path will be faulty, in my understanding. Am I clear? Or?
Yeah, I got the first part, yes, but the second part, which was that what could be some possible resources that I could look towards learning more about this?
I would give you many Dalit organizations in Chhattisgarh state today are trying to raise the issue of forest resources in an entirely different manner. I can give you those. Of course, I'm sorry, it's part of the book actually, and you can write to me. The Dalit organization in Odisha, they are trying to collect their various mythical, historical memory around land and trying to construct the environmental meaning of land through their eyes and vision. So that could be. There are initiatives among researchers, writers, Dalit activists to understand this issue of land, land right, land access, land conservation, which is a very burning issue all over, from the memory of bondage and the bonded laborer. So those efforts are there. So there are building up. Suppose I could not mention to Ravi that Dalit organizations have started working, but that is not a very sound way, that how climate change affect Dalit in a different manner. The location, the mapping, these initiatives, suppose we have celebrated the Forest Rights Act, celebrated or whatever, supported or studied, or whatever. But Dalit activists, Dalit organizations have worked now extensively about the exclusion in the making of Forest Rights Act and its implementation in the past and present. So in spite of the celebration of Forest Rights Act, which is a right case in my opinion, the exclusion of Dalit is now being taken up in a significant manner. So these are the various things that one can. Or you can write to me, I will be happy to give you the references.
Yes, yeah. Thank you.
May I take it since yes,
not asked? No, sorry.
I was just curious. Thanks. In relation to actually her question, we were wondering why the example of this man, Manji, because the act that you describe or that he's lauded for is actually destructive. Like, he didn't actually conserve or protect anything. I understand how he was, what he did was sort of exercise his autonomy as a Dalit man, where he was systematically denied that, like historically, right? He and his people and his wife and all this stuff. But the act, I don't find very environmental at all, because he destroyed the mountain and conceivably ecosystems within it.
Mm.
How is that defined? How would you?
That is entirely my point. That is entirely the crux of my argument. That is crux of my argument.
Yeah, so it's very confusing.
The question is the point.
And that is the point that I want to make you confuse from a Dalit and caste viewpoint, and don't want you to take common as it is portrayed. That why and Dasrat Manji, a Dalit, or that entire village of Dalits see that mountain in a different way. Why? They are not crooked people. They are not destructive people overall. They are people like you and me. They also want to live life happily, humanly, with a good livelihood, and so on and so forth. So the entire point is that a person of a low caste, a person of an untouchable origin, a person who has been deprived of access, ownership, a person who is subjected to various kind of pain, injury, etc., coming out of his labor, forced labor, can see that natural resources in an entire different light. His environmental experiences can be entirely different from yours and from mine. And that's why this point is coming again and again, either by me or by Ravi, that there is, when you are trying to build the environmentalism of today, when people, whether Dalits or ethnic minorities or indigenous, are acquiring their own voice, including Dalits, then there is nothing like an universal environmentalism. Then mountains or commons can only be preserved when those mountains and commons are free from the bondage, pain, agony, when they're open for the ownership and access to all, when they are in some way or whatever way possible can be freed from those historic memories and pains. So that is entirely the point. And that's why Dasrat Manji, in a short span of time, I could not give you. Suppose Dasrat Manji, just to give you an example, when Dasrat Manji started this transforming the mountain, and it was a very slow process, obviously, with the hammer and what, and that. So many villagers of his caste suggested to use the blast, the small bomb, and to.
Yeah.
And he was the one who opposed tooth and nail. Even then, his fellow people insisted to use the. He sat on hunger strike. That I will not allow anybody to destruct or to cut through the mountain in that destructive manner, because this mountain is me. I also have the feeling and belonging to this mountain. So I will not allow the blasting to this mountain. I will carry through my own labor. So. He had a different attachment to the mountain, a different view about the mountain. And that's why his perspective of environmental conservation on mountain was certainly different from my perspective or your perspective in this case.
Right.
So that's the point. You wanted to say something?
No, it is a very complex, it's a very complex action,
yes.
Almost ritualistic.
Yes. Radhika Govindraj.
Radha Kumbh.
On animal intimacy, the ethnographer. She talks about other things, about animal sacrifice, about the relationship of the family with the calf, which is then sacrificed. And it is not that there's a lack of attachment to that calf, which is sacrificed, but there's a whole other set of negotiations. With the calf, which is like her, like a child, is allowed to be sacrificed. So the balance in which something is done, of the greater what constitutes a certain negotiation, is not the universalizing negotiation that this is a good mountain and this is bad. So there are these complex relationships which he's referring to, I believe. So please correct me, because I don't want to. To say something wrong.
Yeah, but then what about?
Because we are assuming what is good environment, what is environmental, and what is not environmental.
But I think within this sort of silenced voice, what about the silenced voice of the calf or the mountain? Like, where is their autonomy in all of this? Because we are again, I feel, it's a human. It's human autonomy.
So we are entering into a completely different area of animal of animal agency. So that'll take another lecture, another set of discussions. So you're completely right in pointing out the complexity. But even realize that this complexity exists is a great starting point to think. But I won't let you be unheard. So since you've anyway extended, please do ask the final question, and then we'll stop.
Still a continuation from hers and the points that she had made. Still uncertain about how caste defines Manji's experience of the mountain. Like a person who has had the kind of experience that he has, having lost his wife, and lived in a place which he has, which is rather inaccessible. I don't really know if him being of a certain caste colored the action that he took.
So because certainly I could not deal those details here. But my entire point is after, because I have been meeting with Manji since, of course he died in 2007, but I was meeting with him since the past 15, 20 years, first as a journalist, traveling to that area. It was always fascinating to me that how a person of materially no worth is working on a mountain. What is the thing that is driving him to work through the mountain, creating a road, and what does he think about mountain? What does he think about the, his efforts, forest, and so on and so forth? And not only he, along with him, his villagers, his family, his son, his daughter, and so on and so forth. So A, that, which I also briefly mentioned, that for Manji or for, and of course, Manji actually comes in this world in one century. He's a unique person. For 22 years to continue day and night, it doesn't happen every year by everybody. So anyway, that the greatness of, he was, I can give you many, he was the one seeing the plight of his villagers during the flood and drought, and he had no money. After doing this thing, started his journey from that village to Gaya, from village Gaya to Delhi, taking the railway line. And he, three months he traveled through the railway line from Gaya to Delhi, and he reached and he wanted to see the Prime Minister of that time, to talk to the Prime Minister about the river, and the various ways to construct and reconstruct rivers so that that village should not get drowned every year by flood. And so that's unique. Leave that uniqueness and then that kind of a thing. But his social world, that was very much characterized by the land, water, forest, that mountain, which was full of agony and pain and backbreaking labor and so on and so forth. That was his social world. And he could not see the water as a resource of conservation, and he could see water land as a place to do the life-breaking labor, and that was the also source of his subjugation, because he was tied with the bond land as a bonded labor. That was his social world. And his personal world, also along with tied with the natural resources, where one has to travel kilometers and kilometers together to go to the working place, other than the local working place, and so on and so forth. And his personal world, his whole pain, which came through the mountain. Not only he lost his, I could not mention, he lost his wife, but he also lost his son by a wild animal in the forest. So all these created his particular distinct different views about a common, that how a common should look like, how a common should be restructured or recreated by human labor, how that common should open the path also for his way forward, for his liberation, and should be free of the wildlife, should be free of the inaccessibility, and so on and so forth. So that created, in my thing, his different environmental sensibility, which was not, of course, the blasting and all, and these many, and the way he contested to Forest and Environment Department and to the police, and so on and so forth. But those all created his 22 years' labor on common in a very different way, and that he could persist. And that also rallied behind the entire look. And mind it, in that entire journey, though barring a few exceptions from the higher caste people like us, those who supported his cause, most of the land-owning class in that entire area, in the entire village, were against this kind of a effort on mountain and commons, because they were the one who were owning that common forest. They were the one who were owning that forest land in the mountain. They were one, the one who were using those resources and so on and so forth. It was not the Dasrat Mandi and so that actually makes the that in that way I understand if I answered you. So, but still I would be happy to send you, which gives very detailed 20,000 words account of his becoming a mountain man and the way he described his labor, mountain, forest, his journey, and so on and so forth. Yeah.
Thank you, Mukul, for an excellent discussion. We started off with saying, where do I get the resources to understand experientially what you're saying? Because I'm not in that experience. So I can only intellectually think of the experience. I remember when I was working with fishers in South India, one of the questions which kept coming to my mind when I was talking to them, that are we talking of the same sea? So is the sea I see the sea he sees? So this assumption that we understand, because I think our understanding is so based in a certain interest of something, and we see this in the gender debate so much, when it overturned everything, when we looked, what does nature and gender mean, in a sense? You know, what does the forest mean? That social and economic relationship changes so much. And that's why I'm saying that what he's saying is so important, because cutting through our axis of understanding and assuming what we think we know and actually we don't know, in a sense. But thank you very much for taking the time coming here twice now and being so patient with all of us. Thank you. Thank you.